this one's for Alan McGee. Live forever.
He's lived a rock and roll dream without actually being in a rock and roll band, which is top work, you know. Doesn't even have to go on stage and play.
He built his own recording stable up from nothing to becoming one of the greatest boutiques, if you like, for popular music in the last 10, 15 years.
He's not corporate. He's not scared, he's not worried, he doesn't care what anyone else thinks except himself.
I walk a road of flamboyant failure. He walks a road of benign success.
Alan. Yeah, how are you doing? Good to see you, Alan.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Hello. Alan McGee is one of the most successful businessmen in the country. Through his company, Creation Records, he's amassed a personal fortune of £25 million. Like Brian Epstein and the Beatles, Malcolm McLaren and the Sex Pistols, he's part of that select band of pop impresarios whose name is synonymous with the bands they've discovered.
You've got to get it together, get an agent, you know.
We're ready tomorrow.
Yeah, now, because we need to get playing.
If you say to yourself that I was going to have 18 years in the music business, right, and that I was going to be really well paid and I was going to become a multi-millionaire out of it, and I was going to, like, you know, find, you know, the biggest group in the world and put out some of the most important records in the world, I think most people would say I'll have some of that and worry about it when I'm 40.
He has been a millionaire and he has been virtually bankrupt. He has been a drug addict and he now isn't. He has been the most famous record boss in the world for a brief period of time when Oasis were big, and now he isn't. I don't think Alan McGee is necessarily a great businessman. What Alan McGee is an A&R man. Alan McGee has great ears for a certain type of music. He hears a certain type of music and he knows that how to convert that into something that people will want to buy.
Alan McGee grew up in Glasgow, in the streets around Hampden Park, the home of Scottish football. As a teenager, the first band that really grabbed him were the Sex Pistols.
I got into punk kind of earlier than anybody else I knew. I got into punk June 1977. I was trying to sort of like break away from the horrible time that I'd had at school, which was like this really almost like institution type thing, you know, into like, you know, like breaking away into this world that all these people that were too square to get into it, and punk was my world. So punk was the first thing that I ever truly related to.
That was a great cause celeb for any kid living in the back streets of Glasgow, where I think Alan McGee stemmed from. It was a warrior's cry, and stopped him putting the pillow over his head every morning, and allowed him to live a life as awful as he possibly could, and breed success doing it, make cash, as he obviously saw in the great rock and roll swindle movie, out of chaos.
McGee's background is traditional Glasgow working class. His father worked as a panel beater.
That really grounded me, actually, watching him go out every day to do a job that he never really wanted to do for his family. It makes you realise how lucky you are at the end of the day doing something you want to do. He also drilled a load of nonsense into in my head and my sister's head that you're not supposed to enjoy your job, you're supposed to go and, you know, it's almost like a kind of like a concentration camp existence. And if you're put in a corner and, and life has to be like that, then it has to be like that. But, you know, it doesn't necessarily, you know, you can actually strive and dream.
Oh, he always wanted to be a star. I mean, his career officer, when he went along with his mother, they had said to him, what would you like to be in life? And he says, a pop star. And he says, oh, don't think you'll ever be a pop star. It's only one in a million that becomes that. And then he says, well, I'd like to be a footballer. And he says, do you play football? He says, not very much. He says, but I could probably learn. And they laughed at him at that. However, I suppose he got his first wish. He's maybe not exactly behind the mic, but he's a pop star in his own right with what he's doing at the moment.
McGee's pop career was short-lived. He played bass in a succession of guitar bands which were characterised by their consistent failure to make the top 40.
About 1982, I did realise realistically that, you know, I could play the guitar and I could write songs, but at the end of the day, I wasn't very good, really. So, yeah, I think it was a realistic viewpoint, really, and it was good that I kind of came to that conclusion at 22 instead of 32.
The next best thing to playing on records was to make them. So he moved to London, the centre of the music business, and in 1984 set up Creation Records.
What he transferred out of wanting to be a pop star into being a label manager, he was kind of like the man with the most aspirations, far larger than any of the bands were on the label for a long time up until Oasis.
The first successful band he signed were also from Scotland, the Jesus and Mary Chain.
We done a sound check, first ever gig. It was our first ever gig at all. We stood on stage, oh, sound check, it's a joke. We just stood there and sort of made a racket, and me and William, I think, ended up having a fist fight with each other. And Alan just ran up and said, that's it, I want to sign you, 5-album deal. And we went, oh? We were standing there thinking we'd just blown it. And it turns out that we'd just done exactly what was necessary.
When I was working at Melody Maker, I was the reviews editor many years ago, Alan came in the office. He was this little feisty little Scots bloke who had his own label and his own band. And he said, I have discovered the greatest rock and roll band in the world. And they are called the Jesus and Mary Chain. And everybody went, yeah. And then, you know, 3 weeks later, everybody's going, yeah.
And the Mary Chain overnight really did just become a total phenomenon, you know. And I can always remember folding sleeves. And as we would fold a box of 50, Rough Trade would come and take them and sell them. We couldn't fold enough records. We couldn't keep it in stock fast enough.
At the time, you got to think of the state of British pop music, and it was the early 80s. Everyone was trying to sound so bloody bright and shiny and new, and it was the great new pop explosion, and you know, some of that was all right, but ultimately it was just trash. And at that point, you really wanted to I wanted to hear something that just blew all that away.
What Jesus and Mary Chain did was they started the British rock and roll revolution, really.